So thank you, and I'm proud to be here to talk with you, with the families. I'm so pleased. Thank you for the invitation. And again, please block me, stop me anytime, raise your hand for any type of questions or to explain better what I'm saying. Before to start, just give me the possibility to briefly introduce myself. So my background is on genetics. I have obtained my bachelor in medical biotechnology at the University of Milan in Italy. And I obtained a PhD in molecular medicine. And I was a postdoc at the University of California, Irvine, some years ago. I've published about 30 scientific articles on genetic diseases. And about my current appointment, I'm the project manager of Kaleidos. This is a small non-profit organization in Italy. We manage the facility for people with mental disorders. As Issa say, I'm the scientific coordinator for you, for Ring14 International. I'm collaborating also with a public entity in Italy for research, for providing funds to research. I'm a reviewer for this organization. And we have just found a startup in telemedicine. The name of this startup is Net Medicare, and the objective is to make the possibility for patients, doctors, to meet each other using an internet platform. So working, collaborating association with an entity for genetic diseases is very, very exciting to work in these days in the genetic field in something really, really exciting. There are very new development in this field, new technologies available that can help us to better understand the basic mechanism of genetic field. And working with an association provide the possibility to interact, to collaborate with the different stakeholders involved in genetic field. So, as we learn from Issa, it's very important to have an international picture, so to collaborate with the different nations at an international level. Of course, there is the connection with researchers, and I have several slides during my presentation to explain more about our research projects. Of course, families are involved, assume. It's important, the relationship with the medical doctors, clinicians. There is a very important impact of the social possibility to help families, and also the possibility to make trainings and a conference to share more experience to everybody. So this briefly our agenda for my presentation today. I have divided my presentation in two different parts. I would like to give you a general overview on the genetic field now. And it's already used at least two magic words that I use again during my presentation. The first one is networking. So it's very important. We are a little association, but we are part of a larger family. So it's important to have to build new relationship with other entities involved in genetic disease. And the other word is therapy, is the cure. So until very few years ago, the genetic disease in general were not curable disorders. Now we start to come back to the patients with the first therapies available. Okay, I know that it's much more easy to have therapies available for monogenic disorder, So diseases which involve very few genes and very few organs, it's much more difficult to treat a syndrome with different organs are affected. But we have to trust to research, and we can learn that therapies can be available in the next future. After this general overview on genetic disease, I will enter on what we are doing for within Ring 14 International, the scientific part. And I will show you our achievement and what we have done in the few last years. I will talk you about the guidelines that have been published recently. You have the paper in your folder. I will show you some information about the grants that we are supporting. I will talk about the biobank and the clinical database and other major achievements that we have obtained. So let's start with a general overview in the genetic field. So genetics is a quite aged discipline. It started at least in the 50s when Watson and Crick described the DNA molecule. But let me say that for the following 30 years, this discovery was this discovery didn't have a very important impact because we missed very good technologies to study until the first year of the 80s, when Kerry Mullis, granted with the Nobel Prize, described this technology, the PCR, the polymerase chain reaction, that is a molecular typer to copy the single molecule of DNA to a lot of more molecules, and in this way we can start to study really in deep the DNA molecule. Another important step was in the 1996 when the bioinformatics and the microengineering start to collaborate with the genetics, and we had the possibility to analyze a lot of amount of DNA, of genes, of chromosomes together in the unique in a single experiment. And this helped a lot to contribute to understand better what's going on. And of course, in 2003, there is the release of the Human Genome Project. And with the Human Genome Project, we start to acknowledge and to know better our genome, our entire genome. With the release of the Human Genome Project, we know everything about the DNA? Absolutely not, because we learn that more with the new technologies, we start to learn more in deep what is the structure, the molecules of DNA, but there are so many different complexity that more complexity in DNA. So is what we know is just a small part of the huge iceberg. So there is no time to analyze all the different complexity in our DNA and our heredity habits. But one issue very important to learn is that is so heterogeneous the DNA that there are people who inherit the same variants, the same mutation, but they have a very different phenotype. And there is, there are people with the same alteration, the same DNA variations, but some people develop symptoms and other people they don't. And the reason is that there are other genes in our genome that contribute to develop the symptom. These are the modifier genes. So there are positive modifier genes and negative modifier genes. With the same mutation, there are other genes as a big orchestra that can help to develop the symptoms or to protect against affected symptoms. So we know that the genetic diseases are rare and orphan. But is this really true? Okay, of course, genetic diseases are rare. There are more than 7,000 of different diseases due to genetic alteration. 80% of these rare diseases, they have a very well-known genetic basis. And only in the United States, more than 30 million of people are affected by rare diseases. 50% of these people are children, so rare diseases is a big issue, especially in pediatrics, in the pediatrics field. And the rare diseases are responsible for at least one third of death in the first year of life. So genetic diseases are really rare and are orphan from the point of view of an available therapy, but are not orphan from the interest of the public, of the civic, of the social civic public system. If we look at what are the funds available through NIH, you know NIH is the major funds opportunity for science in US, and there are almost 5,000 of million of dollars available through NIH in the rare disease field in the last year.
Yeah, so give us some perspective here. You may not know the answer, but you do. So National Institute of Health, NIH, so 5 million for rare syndromes,
five billion.
So what is the overall budget for NIH? In other words, how big a slice of the pie is that?
This is a good question. I don't have the data with me, but we can.
I'm looking.
Okay, good. I extracted this data from the NIH website. So there was a table with a list of a different field, different disorders.
I just asked that, and we'll come back to it later, because I think it's always important to know, well, how much of that is the total budget it is.
So $30 million a year. Okay. In medical research funding.
Okay, so that's
5 out of 30. It's a lot. So the message is that, okay, genetic diseases are rare, but are not orphan from the interest from the public entity. You know what I mean? And okay, in Europe, the amount is much more smaller, but compared to other fields, is still in Europe an important budget dedicated to genetic field. And for 2018, of course, is an estimation, okay? Genetic disorders are not orphan, especially because there is a very high patient engagement now. Now patients need to be involved to drive the research on their disorders, and they need to have back the results from the bench, okay? Is another important thing. So genetic disorders are not orphan anymore because there is a good collaboration, profit and no profit. Now, pharma, big companies in the pharmaceutical field wants to be part of the game. So start to sign collaboration agreements with the patient organization, with other source of funding, because they understood how it's important to be involved in the genetic field, in the rare genetic field. And there are very important new platform. Another word that Issa said they used during her presentation is the partnership. So it's important to network, and there are new platform now available to help to share information, data, results among scientists, among patients, among clinicians involved in this field. You have any question? Something to clarify? Okay, this is one of the platform available. I would suggest to keep the address. The Gene Equip Project is a website where you can find, you can browse, you can download a lot of tools, material, and is specific for people without a genetic background. So there are tutorial, videos, documentation. This is free. Everything you find in this website is free. And maybe you can share with teachers for your children. And this project was awarded last year with the European Health Award. It's a very, very important award in Europe. It's available in different languages, not just in English. So if you have any contact with a non-English native speaker, this website is in 7 or 8 different languages available. RD Connect is another project, is a worldwide project. There are about more than 30 different entities, partner in this project. Rare disease, RD stays for Rare Disease Connect. So the objective, the final aim of this project is to create a unique platform with the three pillars of genetic diseases. So biological samples, clinical data, and genetic data. So to put together and to create a platform to share information in for these three pillars for all the genetic diseases. There are partners, of course, in Europe. The project was born in Europe with European fund, but there are also American partners involved, Australian from Japan. So it's a worldwide project. And everything in this project is free as well as the previous project I showed with the slide before. So again, there are registries, biological samples, genetic data available in this platform with the objective to share as much more information with the full picture of stakeholders. RE14 International is a part of this project. We are a member of the core implementation group. So there is a large group within this project. We are a sort of a testing. So when a new platform, when a new tool is available in this project, is being tested by the CIG, the core implementation group, before to be released to everybody, to the outside. I was talking with you, I guess, with this other platform. This is not a platform, this is a consortium. The acronym is very difficult for an Italian native speaker. International Rare Diseases Research Consortium. The aim, the objective of this worldwide consortium is to provide the guidelines for research in the rare disease field. And there are some aims that are very important, are on diagnosis. The objective is not just that all 7,000 of genetic disorders need to have a diagnosis, a genetic test available. But the main objective is that everybody can obtain a diagnosis within the first year of access in a clinical facility. Okay, now you know that better than me how long is the traveling to find the correct diagnosis. This is not right. Everybody has the right to have a diagnosis soon, not more than 1 year of the first access. This is the objective of here of this project. Diagnosis is not the only aim, but the other aim we talked before is to have therapies. So now there is the possibility to...
So you're saying
diagnosis. Diagnosis and therapies. These are the two main objectives of this consortium. And the main objective is to have 200 new therapies before 2020. And we are very close to this objective.
What is an example of
a
therapy?
I have a couple of examples. We can go. Okay, probably the answer is here. You know the Angelina Jolie effect. So Angelina Jolie is affected by genetic disorders on genes BRCA1 and 2 that create tumors on mammalian and ovaries. The Angelina choice was to remove everything to anticipate the symptoms. But the good news, as you ask me about therapies, starting from January 2018, there is available the first FDA-approved therapy for people as Angelina who carries this kind of mutations. This is not the only case. We are still crying at the death of one of the most brilliant minds we had in this century. And Dr. Hawkins was also affected by a genetic disorder, the spinal atrophy. These are classical genetic disorders. But the good news that we have also a therapy available for some forms of these disorders. So these are just a couple of examples, but now there are about 200 genetic diseases with a therapy available. Again, not all people affected by that disorder can be treated. It depends which kind of mutations you have within your gene.
So for therapy to be called effective, I know that with ADs, with anti-epileptic drugs, kind of the gold standard for whether something is the effective standard is a 50% reduction in 50% of the population. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. So is that kind of across the board with different therapies? Is that how they designate that this is an effective therapy?
Yes, exactly. Is the percentage, yeah.
And they're all different, yeah. Right? So depending on what outcome you look at in your child is how they define and what is effective at changing that outcome. So ADDs, it's from seizures. In other disorders, it's whatever presentation
you want. Yeah, the issue is the personalized medicine. Yeah, with the same medicine, with the same clinical picture, with the same genes affected, we respond differently. There is another running field within genetics that is pharmacogenetics. So you know that everybody responds to the same treatment in different way. And the reason is that we have a different genetic background in some genes that are involved in the metabolizing drugs. And this is another very, very important field of research.
Yes.
Yes. I don't know if Marco will go into it at all, but with regards to therapies, and also there's physical therapies, and here he's mentioned a couple of drug therapies. There's also certain cases where physicians can introduce a gene. So there's gene therapies, and in some cases, cellular therapies. stem cells, for example. So there's the word therapy, I think, has lots of different meanings in a medical context here.
Diet therapies, ketogenic diet, stuff like that. So very broad.
Yeah. We have, in general sense, in group 14, I've had a little diagram in the bottom, the basic genetics. You get one thing from your mother and father, that there's four possibilities. With group 14, something's happening between when you're given and when you receive, that complicates the research, I'm sure.
You are absolutely right. We still don't know how is what are the exact mechanisms during the ring 14 formation, and if there is some variation in parents affecting the chance to create the rings. We don't know this picture. However, the message is that we have to trust in research, because it's possible. There is the concrete possibilities to have therapies. We have to remember these dates are very, very recent. So if therapies start to be available now, this scenario was absolutely different until very few years ago. And of course, again, SMA is a genetic disorder, is a monogenic genetic disorder, so it's probably more easier to find a cure for a disorder where there is only one or two genes involved. With a syndrome is very difficult, but there is the possibility to have in the future some therapies. Maybe they can't cure definitely all the syndromes, but we can reduce some of the major symptoms, and is a very important goal. Okay. I am done with the first part of the presentation, so to give you a general information on the most interesting breakdown on genetics. If you have any questions, otherwise we can start to look at our achievements, starting from the guidelines. To provide the guidelines for genetic disorders is within the best standards for rare diseases. So it's quite important that every genetic disorders develop dedicated guidelines to help people, parents, as you, in the when they receive the diagnosis for his children. So this work, this paper, is absolutely compliant with the best practice of rare diseases. The kickoff meeting was on September 2015. I have a slide to see with you all the process. It was a long process from the kickoff meeting to the publish of these papers. That was effectively published on 2017 on the Orphan Journal for Rare Diseases, that is one of the most important journals in this field. Why it's important to have, to publish recommendations, guidelines for ring 14 syndrome? As you know, ring 14 is not just rare, it's very, very rare, as Issa said before. The prevalence is so low. It's not a very well-studied disorder. There are about 70 published articles in PubMed. You know PubMed, that is the most important bibliography for science. And you know better than me what is the sense of frustration by parents at the time of the diagnosis if the disorder is not well known. So in the kickoff meeting that I show in the previous slide, we appointed a multidisciplinary pool of experts in different fields to make this paper published. This article, we are very proud, very happy for this achievement, but this is not a decalogue. the guidelines must be keep updated. We have to revise it in the next years, maybe including new experts. This first version was made by a pool of Italian experts. So we wish to have experts from other parts of the world to increase again the quality of these guidelines. So it's a very good project. It's a helpful tool to share with your clinicians, with anybody you think is need, but we need to revise again in the future. Issa probably already knows that I like to show number, graph, pictures, tables, and I know that nobody are very happy with this stuff, but I have the privilege to talk today, so you have to watch number and the graph. 37. 37 is the number of the suggested recommendation you can find in this paper. They are divided in 7 fields. The diagnosis, the general follow-up, the treatment of the major symptoms, respiratory issues, nutritional support, anything related to the communication skills, and the scientific aspects. I can go quite fast. You have everything in your hand. These are some issues about the process we used to finalize this recommendation. We didn't discover anything. We apply a standard process that was used by other researchers for other disorders. However, we have to join a consensus from all the pool of experts, and everybody was asked to provide a score A, B, or C according to their knowledge, their background on these 37 recommendations. You can find, if you are interested, the reference of the papers with the guidelines to use this approach. 9. 9, I told you before, this paper comes from an effort by Italian clinicians, researchers. They are based in 9 different locations in Italy, 9 different hospitals, 9 different clinical centers, research centers. So it was a real networking effort. 19. 19 is the number of months, the time span that went from the kickoff meeting to the date of publish. And it started, as I said before, on September 2015 during the meeting of the Italian families, as we are doing today. And we start to appoint a core group, a more restricted group of experts, just to start to think about the recommendation. At the beginning, there were 50 recommendations, but some of these were cut because the consensus was not joined. So the preliminary draft was available for the internal usage on the beginning of 2016. After that, started the task force. So everybody started to think, to work very deep on the manuscript. There were a lot of video conference, teleconference, a lot of emails to arrive to the final version. At on the late 2016, there was the review of the revision of the manuscript by the board of directors, where Issa is chair, and there is the approval by the scientific advisory board with Andrew and all the other experts. So the papers prepared, drafted by the expert was revised or reviewed by two other bodies to increase the quality of this manuscript. On January 2017, there was the finalization, and very few months later, the Orphan Journal of Rare Disease approved the paper and decided to publish.
Yes.
So I just have one comment about this paper and the guidelines, is that, and I think Marco said this, but I just want to emphasize it. So not only was it a product of researchers and clinicians, but it also had input from parents. So with the board, when we got together in Barcelona in 2017, I guess, or 16, something, but we got to read this and we got to look at it from a parent standpoint and say, what do we think is important for other families to know? What would we add? And so it was very much a collaborative process where we got to say, oh, I really think this needs to be emphasized, or how come CBD oil isn't in here? Should we say more about this? It's an emerging thing. So in other words, when Marco was talking about that this needs to be redone, I want all y'all to keep in mind that we have a voice in this particular paper. Like we have, we get to share our ideas. So when you guys read this paper, think about, well, what's changed since this was written? What would I like to see included on that in the future? Is there something that my child has that's not mentioned? Maybe there is consensus. Maybe we haven't asked the right questions to our families. So in other words, I want y'all to see this as an opportunity and to kind of take some ownership in this process as it goes forward, because we do have a voice at the table on these kinds of papers. So.
Thank you, Issa. No, Issa is absolutely right. When we submitted this paper to this journal, we received the comments by the reviewers, and they were very, very happy. And one of our was this reason to have the people, the final stakeholder involved in this project was an added value of this project, of this paper. Okay, and just highlighting how long it took to prepare this and finalize this project. 19 months. And zero. Zero is how much it cost for RIM 14 International. Zero. Zero not because to make research is free. To make research is very, very expensive. But we didn't pay anything for this project for two main reasons. The first reason that everybody gave their contribute for without asking anything fee. And we have to be very proud for these collaborators. And the publication costs were completely covered by an Italian health public entity. About $3,000 total paid by this Italian public entity. This is the webpage from the journal. You can't see here. This is the number of the download of these papers. I just revised this number very few days ago. 2,262 download. It means that worldwide, more than 2,000 of people download and read this paper. Everybody, scientists, doctors, patients, families. So we really hope that this effort can help a lot of people and to start to a new idea, new field of research for RIM 14. Some question? Thank you. Okay. On the Italian media, there was a lot of impact of this paper. You can see how many different websites, press release use this paper to increase the visibility. I'm done with the first achievement, and we can move to the call for projects, so the grant that we issue, if you don't have any questions. What is the objective, the final objective to issue call for grants? The final objective, the final aim is to stimulate new people, new researchers, new scientists to work on Ring 14 and on the other syndromes related to the chromosome 14. We saw before, these are the number of papers, not just on Ring 14, but also in other disease involved with the deletions or rearrangement on the chromosome 14. So are quite few. And I prepare a comparison between Ring 14 and other genetic disorder, and using three data: the prevalence, so how rare is the disease, the number of publications, and the number of clinical trials. So for Ring 14, prevalence is very rare, about very few publications available, and no clinical trials available. I would like to compare this data with other syndromes. Chorea of Huntington, you probably know this disorder. It's rare, but not so rare as a Ring 14. There are a lot of articles published, more than 12,000 of articles available, and almost 1,000 of clinical trial. Is a very, very bad disorder. You know the chromosome 21 trisomy, the Down syndrome, is not rare, or at least is not so rare as the other syndromes. It's a very, very well-known disorder. And there are a good number of clinical trials available. You know progeria? Is a disorder where people affected, children affected, got aged very quickly. Okay? It's very rare, as our. But it's a quite known disorder, about 2,000 of articles available in PubMed, and there are already 7 clinical trials. MLD is a deeply disorder in the first 5-6 years of age. It's quite rare, well studied. We got the therapy. ADA deficiency, okay, similar prevalence than the before, than MLD. Number of articles, we got the therapy. Oh, what happened? What is the message? That to get therapy is not important the prevalence, but is absolutely important how much is funded. MLD and the ADA deficiency are very rare, but are quite highly funded, and they got therapy. Sorry? Okay, I can talk about the last two. Is an Italian experience, Teleton. I was in work with Teleton, that is a major charity in Europe, funded the research, and they fund a lot in for these disorders. So Teleton, we were lucky to find good researchers, very, as I said before, good science. So, good science, good scientists, very well funded, and they got the therapy. Is the reason.
You say with regard to progeria and ADA, ADA deficiency was probably well funded because it was one of the first obvious candidates for gene therapy. It's a single gene. Yeah. So we have a question about how often we can fix this one gene. So it was sort of a booster child for gene therapy. And the progeria is the kind of thing that everybody is ultimately affected by old age. So for people which is a lot of interest in setting green community. Right. So what's wrong to align to keep it some age with that? So I think those are a couple of things.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I would say one other thing that contributes to how well-funded consumption is unfortunately the science and stuff like that. Sometimes projects, I'm going to use this term very loosely because it's used, but it's a sexy project. It has like appeal. So like for instance, the story of Rogerio, there's been movies made about this. And you know what I mean? It has a face and people recognize it and the community becomes funded, okay? That's one of the reasons for video TV today is because this raising awareness and this idea of telling your story is so profound in how we raise money for this organization. And I want y'all to know that you can play such a big role in this. And some of the parents already have, and I know that it's daunting at first, but at the very end of the conference, I'm just going to say a little spiel about how I can help you fundraise. But the important thing I want to make here is that you never know when you tell your story who is going to be affected and who buys in and who has money to spend. So at our last charity dinner just a couple of months ago, one of the people in the audience who's actually been a long-time funder of Freak 14, but he was a funder because Andrew's mother has known him for years, and when Mika says look at this project, sometimes people just look to the project, you know what I mean? And she has kind of that kind of presence in the community. But he came to the dinner because he kind of fell in love with the story of Ring 14. He started mad to come out here and film our story. He wants to present it to Mass Mutual and have it be kind of a highlighted charity at their conventions, at their conferences next year. Who would have thought that it's so important for y'all to talk to people and share your story and share your challenges, because people all over the world have huge hearts, but we can't be shy to ask because we can be the next Virginia. You just don't know. Something that comes out of our research project can help somebody else's Rett syndrome. So it's two sides that can help us, but we also have the potential to help
Thank you.
One more thing. I completely agree with everything you just said. And I think the other thing to keep in mind is when you're looking to get more and more funding from a source like the National Institutes of Health, which has billions of dollars of research funding available, the way they make their funding decisions is about the best scientific opportunity. Because that comes from a philosophy that if you fund the best scientific opportunity, the results have impact on many, many, many different areas that you don't even anticipate during the funding. So one of the reasons that some of these disorders are getting more of that NIH funding is because there's a really good scientific opportunity that can be identified and researchers can develop projects for that particular scientific opportunity. But in order to get to that point, you have to have a place to start. You have to have a hook. And so I think the work that you guys are doing to fund these grants is setting you up now to allow researchers to come into NIH with really well-designed projects that are going to capture that scientific opportunity.
And I think Mark is going to tell about the success story that we have, because we actually got almost 400,000, 370,000 from a recent NIH grant that came out of little bitty 50,000 euro grants. So we started the process and we were able to go to the next step and seek funding from a higher source. So I'll let you tell that story, but very important.
Thank you for your contribution. You already learned about two takes on take-home messages. So the first one is money is money. So progeria, seven clinical trials. One of these come from the French Peloton, that is a lot of funds. So with a lot of funds, you can run up the progress to arrive to join a cure. And the second one, please never say, okay, we are just six families, who cares about us? This is absolutely not true. And this number can prove it. Okay? So, the objective to issue a call for grants is to stimulate new scientists to join us, to work for us. Is the reason because we start to open calls for project to anybody in the world, to any scientist in the world. As I was saying, these are seeding projects. The budget that goes to the scientists is €50,000, about $50,000. Is not too much. It's about for a 1 year project. It's impossible to hope to arrive to a therapy with €50,000. It's a very, very too small amount, but it's enough to start a project, to collect new data, new preliminary data, to obtain, to apply for a major source of funding, as I was saying. So again, the objective is to stimulate new people to focus on our syndromes, exploratory project, open new fields, new view on our research. Any scientist in the world can apply. We received application from different countries. Budget is quite limited, but it's okay to start something new. Andrew is part of our peer review process, and okay, this is just a comics, but I can highlight what is the objective. So we receive the applications, and the application are evaluated by external expert reviewers that can find the best science. This is another word that we continue to say again, but it's important. $50,000 must go to the best scientist. And Andrew and the other people appointed in the scientific advisory board, they have this very important role to guarantee transparency, meritocracy, and efficacy, efficiency. I already said, so we ask our scientists to collect preliminary data to apply to other major sources of funding. We issue so far two calls, the first one in 2015 and the another one in 2016. Two calls under Ring 14 International. Ring 14 Italy in the previous year opened another kind of call, but it was kind of different process. So, within Ring 14 International, two calls for three total projects funded. We received a total 15 letter of intent. The letter of intent are the preliminary letter just to inform Ring 14 that the scientist would like to apply to obtain these funds. We make an initial check, evaluation, and from these 15 letters of intent, we received 11 applications. 11 applications from 11 scientists, of which 8 are new. So thanks to this approach, we stimulate 8 new people to prepare to think about Ring 14 and to think about a solution. 8 new people that never known about Ring 14 start to think about us. We receive, okay, about 50% of these people are located, these scientists are located in Italy, but we received also application from USA, Brazil, Netherlands, and Germany. These are the first achievement. Three posters presented in international meetings. There are two articles already published, but I have a focus slide dedicated to the articles. And as I was anticipating before, one NIH project. So this is a success. The applicant received €50,000 from us, she obtained the preliminary data, enough good to receive $250,000 from NIH, thanks to our initial support. Is that okay? Good. Just an overview on our projects funded under the RIM14 umbrella. The first one is to produce IPS, so stable cells, that can be a model for RIM14. It's very important to have on the bench some models that are much more similar as possible to the clinical phenotype. So, Wishon Boris is one of our grantees. He's an outstanding researcher in the world in this field, in the stem cell and in the creating IPS from different kind of disorder. The objective is to have cells that can formate rings on demand, okay, using some particular molecules. And another good thing is that when this model will be done, Wishon Boris donated to everybody. So will be available to our biobank. So any other scientist that would work with this kind of model can apply to obtain from our biobank. There are already two papers published thanks to RIM14 International by Wishon Boris. Nancy Spinner is a researcher from Philadelphia. She obtained the NIH grant from the previous slide. And she's working on RIM14 chromosome in neuronal tissue cells. The first article will be published quite soon. And the grant by Nancy Spinner is a kind of renewal because she obtained from RIM14 Italy another initial pivotal grant in the past. This is the third and the last one project that we found. The principal investigator is Anna Maria Vezzani. She is based in Italy. The OSS institution is a very well-known, worldwide, recognized, acknowledged scientific center, the Mario Negri Institute. I don't know if somebody of you already knows this center. The project by Anna Maria Vezzani is not concluded yet, will be done in a few months. It was approved by RIM14 Board of Directors on late 2016 in Barcelona. The start effective date was March 2017. And there was some delay because she has to obtain some approval, formal approval by the Italian Ministry of Health for using animal experimental animal. If you can remember well, I say that 1 year project. Actually, Anna Maria Vezzani asked us 18 months because she worked a lot with animals. Animals experiment required more time, so she asked and approved from us an extension for working for 18 months total. The rationale is that there is a strong relationship between the immune system and the development of crisis epileptic seizures. That is a major complication, as you know better than me, in the RIM14 syndrome. And the important news that, as you can imagine, that this rationale is not valid only for RIM14, but can be applied in any other kind of epilepsy. So Anna Maria Vezzani is a very well-known scientist in the epilepsy field. So our the result that she can obtain with our funds can be spread and applied in other epileptic syndrome. Okay, the final aim is to test some anti-inflammatory drugs that she already have. The Mario Negri Institute, the host institution, is a research institute focused on pharmacology. So it's a very good facility to have drug to be tested. So she will test, she's testing this drug specific for reduce the inflammation, and the objective is to reduce also the crisis, the epileptic seizures, and prevent the cognitive deficit in mice, and can be applied also in a human. Is everything clear? You need some clarification? Okay, so we have a lot of expectation for this paper. I talked with Anna Maria very few weeks ago. She have very good results. We can't show now because the project is not done yet, but we really expect to have a very good paper in few months.
Targeting epilepsy, but not specifically RIM14. And I can say that there was a lot of discussion on the board on whether or not we should fund a project that wasn't specific to RIM14. But we decided to fund this because the science was the best. Okay, so we really are trying to buy into this idea that Randy talked about and the others, that when we use these precious stones, that we're going to go after the best science, okay? But this is going to have payoff. Even though it wasn't specifically targeted to RIM14. So I got to meet this researcher last year in December in Washington, and I got to see her talk to a standing room only auditorium. And when a researcher talks, one of the very first slides that they put up there is funding source. Okay? And so the first part, that when she talked last December, she was funded by a major funding operator called Cure, Citizens United for Research in Epilepsy. Okay, so right up there. So all the researchers in the room see Cure up there and they go, oh wow, that's a good funding source. Okay, so when she comes back and she presents on the work that we funded, even though it was a much smaller grant, our name is up there on that slide in front of all of these researchers as a potential funding source. Then people start thinking, well, what can I contribute to RIM14? Because I can tell you, finding research money is hard in this environment. So you can think that $50,000 is much, that it can be a lot, and it looks good because these researchers have to bring in a certain amount of money to keep their programs up. Andrew spends a large portion of his job chasing money. It's not his favorite part of the job, it's not anybody's favorite part of the job, but that's important. So, you know, so I just want to point out that next year at the conference, our name will be up there. We'll go with this RIM14. So this is part of the raising awareness that's so critical. So even though not targeted at RIM14, still has good potential to help our organization.
Good. Thank you. So
just kind of to a question, a couple slides back about the call for work or the, you're putting offers out there to get researchers or so forth through that process. Wondering how that works to people to see, hey, is that just one item of a list of many opportunities and they're, oh yeah, that looks interesting, let me go send that, let me go see if I can work for them. Or is it, are they just putting everything out, there's a list of opportunities and they send it to everybody and hopefully get a call back from somebody? Combination of a few things. I mean, how dedicated are these people? Do we have everything invested? I'm just wondering what, you know, what is it? They see it, they do it 1 year, 50,000 euros, okay, now I'm on the next thing. Or what is that whole process like?
It's a great question. I'll take the first step at it, and then I'll let Marco or Andrea and have them involved in that. One of the ways that we try to be very targeted is through these research workshops. So we invite people who we think are the best in the field for multiple fields, not just genetics or whatever. We invite them in for a short conference, and they actually really enjoy it. They get to, they're in a beautiful setting, they get to brainstorm about something that they haven't thought about from lots of different fields. And then at the end, we tell them in so long, if you're interested in pursuing anything that you've heard in this, please send us a letter of intent. So in that way, we target exactly really who we want to send us research proposals, because our board, our scientific board, our scientific advisor coordinator has already vetted these people as fantastic. Okay, so that's a very targeted call. And plus, we get to tell our story to them. So as the president, you know, as Stefania, we get to talk about our kids. And you'd be surprised how that impact of telling your story has a way of inspiring these researchers. So that's an important component to how we get researchers interested. Now, there's a little bit of attention, so is that a large enough pool? So one of the things that we're constantly talking about is, should we put out a general call to the epilepsy community? And in fact, when I get back in 2 weeks, I've got a call with Penny Dack, who runs the research program for the American Epilepsy Society, about the possibility of co-funding. So do we put out a general call to people who don't know can read 14? Put it on a list of potential things, and maybe we get a whole bunch of grants with it. These guys, that increases their work, because now they have to sift through all of this. And so what I'm trying to say is that we try to strike a balance between handpicking people, and right now we're starting to speak about, do we want to transition into a more broad call to the community? And there's pluses and minuses associated with that.
And then we're going to slide to, is it that the people respond?
Yeah.
It was repeated, or is it you're trying to build a group that's continually over year working on it?
There are two models, and both of them are absolutely valid. One is a model, a top-down model, as it's said, so select the best people in the world and invite them in our workshop to stimulate to work with us. The other one is a model bottom-up. So we open a call and we have to give visibility to our call as much as possible through the social channel, internet, to find, to disseminate, to stimulate other guys to join us. So both models are completely valid, and we should keep both. Yeah.
So the new researchers are risky. Okay, so you don't know if they're going to be good, and you don't know if they're going to be bad, but the potential is that you can get in and stimulate somebody at the very beginning of their career, and maybe they make a career out of studying 14. And so ideally, when we get enough, a big enough research program and monies to fund, we would like to support both ends of this spectrum. We would like to contribute to continue to ask young researchers to get involved, but then we want a dedicated amount that's always going to proven winners, people who know we're going to publish and we know we're going to do good science.
That you want to kind of touch both ends of that center. Give something to
say that. Does that happen to the people
who make it? I'm going to let my husband speak to that because. I think it's too early to say, but yeah, I think it actually could happen. I don't know if any of them are all the way from their pockets. We haven't seen the show through kind of weird. There's a lot of players that we roll in this, and it's lucky for the organization that Pietro, who's mentioned pretty long, that is, he's a neurologist at Yale. He has a daughter that's turned 14. Pietro was not quite Stephen Hawking, but not far from Stephen Hawking. And so that coupled with the fact that, that Stefania, given their both Italian heritage and their Pietro's tongue, so they got together and the first one is International Research Symposium, whatever it's called, drawing some really outstanding people, just like Marco said, Tony Winshaw voice, that makes Western, it's really, really stuff that's some of the best in the world. And so we came over to one of these meetings and got involved, not really because we needed the Ring 14, but one of the days, we didn't even need the $50,000. It was more that he did it as a favor and he thought it was good. And what happened is you develop these personal relationships and then maybe the people, I think, if it's not this field committee, if it feels some, some, I don't know if responsibility is the right word, but they feel even of affiliation, you feel part of the organization. I've seen that firsthand, these people feeling that way. And I think that I have not met Bazzani, Anna Maria Bazzani yet, but the proposal that she's made, and I actually don't know where how her name got in the hat.
She was in one of our research
conferences
because of something.
Yeah,
no, sorry. I think she found out our call on the website.
Yeah, so yeah. She just saw the call. And I mean, I don't remember how that happened.
We never met her.
Really, exciting work. I mean, if this pays off, this payoff can be really hard. And so I didn't know her all, but I had read it, thought it was good. I was really happy that this is that she went to these epilepsy meetings. And it turns out that Anne Marie made a big splash, and a lot of people were coming to see her work. So that might be somebody. And my understanding is that she's fairly early in career.
Anna Maria is about 55 years old.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah,
she's established. Yeah. No, she's. Yeah, the major research institute, they have a grant office searching for funds opportunities. So the Mario Negri Institute probably found our call and invite Anna Maria to apply. However, there are public and private funds opportunities for a scientist, at least in Europe. Now the public funds are really low. So scientists are starving of money searching for private opportunities as well. Okay. So the mouse model of Anna Maria Vezzani, as Isa said, is not focused for RIM14. This is an adding value because the results she can obtain can be spread to other disorders. But however, the mouse model develops symptoms very similar to RIM14. Okay, I would like to, how much time I have?
Lunch specifically starts at noon. We're at 12:10. Let me give you that 7 to 10 minutes. We'll wrap
okay.
up.
Okay.
At the end of the day, we've got an hour and a half set aside for parents.
Okay.
And if we don't get to it all, then we.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
So I'm going to start a watch.
I can do it as okay. fast as possible. Okay, this is our scientist. So we need good science. Good scientist, this is mandatory. And a good scientist to make a good research needs of several things. The first one, of course, is an idea. If the scientist doesn't have any good idea for us, he's not a good scientist, we don't have, we don't need him. But to have a good idea is not enough. We have learned that we need, he needs also money. But a very good scientist with a brilliant idea, plenty of money, is not enough to make a good research. He also needs samples. He also needs the material for his bench. So this is the reason because in 2009, RIM14 Italy start these two projects, start to collect biological samples from donors, from your children, from parents, brother, sister, because to make research, we need samples from the affected guy, but also from the healthy familiar. And also, it's very important to make the biological samples connected to the clinical data. Because it's very important, as you know, to profiling the relationship between the genetic stuff and the phenotype and the clinical part. Good. So in this field, in the field of genetic rare disease, this data, biological data and clinical data are double time important because are precious and because are from rare diseases. So everything is rare, you know, is precious. So these two project, the database and the biobank work together because we have an ID, identification number, a unique ID that can match the data, the clinical data collected in a database together matched with the biological samples collected in our biobank. No, it's not our biobank, it's a biobank, it's a certified biobank, very, very good biobank located in Genoa, in Italy. The manager is Chiara Baldo. I have to acknowledge because she's a very good manager for our biobank. She's not collecting just samples from RIM14, she's collecting samples from several other types of disorders. And this biobank is included in a hospital environment, in a public hospital. RIM14 was the first European association, I don't know in US, but in Europe, RIM14 was the first one to establish an agreement, a written agreement between between a ring, a patients, a family association, and a biobank. It was in 2010. The agreement was just renewed last year. To date, there are about 672 samples collected. Samples, I mean DNA, blood, fibroblast from different members of the same family. About 60-65% of these collected samples were already distributed to other scientists who asked to obtain these samples to study. Many of these went to Nancy Spinner in Philadelphia for the project we were mentioning before. In total, so far, these samples are used, however, in several other projects. Regarding the biobanking, there are at least two big issues. The first one is a biobank requires very high standards for quality, because the biological samples is not easy to manage biological samples. So this facility, this biobank facility, is very well sponsored by the health system and from other fundraising charity to maintain these high standards. And there is also the privacy issues that in Europe we have from May. You never know about the GDPR. It's a new law regarding the privacy, and it's important to acknowledge. We have cost covered by RIM14 International, but are very low. Regarding to the impact of this project, is very high. The costs are quite limited. All the cost for maintaining the samples in the biobank and to ship samples from the biobank to the scientists are covered by other entity. We are responsible for cost only from the family to the biobank, that are quite limited regarding to the other cost, to the other entire cost for manage a biobank. Okay, together with the biobank, there is the clinical project. The clinical database an acknowledgement of the clinical database that RIM14 was invited to join RDConnect for this project, and I can go more fast to this slide, but if you need other information, you can just ask me. Okay, this is the last topic. Yeah, 2 minutes. Oh, so fast. Okay, the trip, the journey to benefit of a therapy is very long and very difficult, as you know. But there are some milestones during this trip, and the milestones are the scientific articles. So before to obtain a very concrete results to provide back to patients, scientists have articles to publish. And I would like just to give you some information on scientific articles that are published in the very last years thanks to our contribute, to the sponsor, to the support, to the collaboration of RIM14 International. So to date, we have 15 articles that have been published thanks to the support of RIM14. There are other 3 articles in preparation, so almost ready to be published in 2018. You can see that we have at least 1 paper per year. And in the last years, there is a little increment. Other than the total number of the published articles, I would like to include also the sites. So it's important that the published articles have been cited by other future articles. You can see in the guidelines that the paper that you have in your folder, there are the references at the end. So it's important that our articles are being cited by others' articles. And you can see the increment times of citation by articles published by RIM14 International. Okay, so we have about 130 citations on 15 papers, so about any papers has been cited so far about 10 times. It's not a very high number, it's not low, but I know, I'm quite confident that this number will increase in the future. You can see in the cake the field where our 15 articles have been published. The majority is in genetics. Linguistics is another important area in green. Linguistics, we have very good collaborators still in Italy. Neurology, biology, and pediatrics are the other three fields. Our activities have been disseminated in this last year. I was invited to present our database in Rome. I was invited also in Rome for another meeting for patients' organization. I was being selected to participate for the guidelines, the paper that we talked before, invited to participate to RDRD Connect and other meeting. I can go faster to not waste too much time. Okay, OMIM, RIM14 syndrome was not cataloged in OMIM. OMIM is the most important catalog for genetic disorder. And we have to make a lot of pressure to OMIM to make RIM14 acknowledged. And finally, on October 2015, we have our page. And we have a number, an ID, 616606. This acknowledgement, this result doesn't have a direct impact on patients, but it's very important for scientists to have the disorder recognized and acknowledged in this database. Probably this is the very last one slide, I hope. I would like to show you some data how we allocate our fund. This data come from RIM14 International plus RIM14 Italy. I don't have Italy, I don't have data from US and the other national chapter. Since 2004 to date, we allocate about 1 million of euro. 48% belongs to activity directly managed by science. So 40% of our budget goes directly for scientific purposes. Okay, scientific projects we talked before, or scientific facility as a biobank and the clinical database. About 35% of this budget goes directly to activity belonging to families. So for project, for clinical purposes or social activities. And the last one, about 17% are used to organize the meeting, conference, scientific workshop. So it's already show you the scientific workshop we planned, we organized in the past. So the first one was in 2006, 32 people attended there. The second one in Pollenzo, still in Italy, 2011, 19 attendance. And the third one in 2014. We wish to have the new World Scientific Workshop in 2019 with a lot of objectives. The first one, of course, is to provide an update by all finished projects. So all the three projects that we showed before, we have to invite our investigators to present the data they collected, stimulate more networking, or recruit new researchers. We already talked about this. Search for other source of funding. So this event could be a good opportunity to scan for other external opportunities for funds we can apply as RIM14 International maybe. And as I said before, we can revise our guidelines. Thank you, everybody, for your attention, and thank you for all to the people, the partners involved in the Ring 14 guidelines. Of course, the Scientific Advisory Board is already mentioned there. All the directors of the board and all the other external partners. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I got in 7 minutes.